you.
Yes, it is.
Amen and amen. Jean, it's good to see your juicy face. Cindy, it's good to see you. Irene and Carrie are here. Pastor Ann Therese, Sue. Eileen, it's good to see you. Dave and Marge are here. It's good to see you. Angela and Donna, it's good to see you. Good to see you, Natalie, as well as Barbara, Ray and Ruth, and Sherry and Ada. Roger, it's good to see you. Amen, amen. People are adjusting to our new time, 9:30. We are also honored to have with us our guest speaker, the Reverend Kendal Brown, is going to be with us this morning, virtually. Here comes also Harry and Sue. Come on in, come on in. Good to see you also. I'm going to get rid of this panel. I don't know if we need this because after a while, I can't see the chat. If the chat comes in, amen. Amen, amen. Good to see and be with each and every one of you. It's about worship time. It's about worship time. I always tell everybody that service, and right now today, Sunday, June 20th, worship is beginning at 9:30. I'm sorry, service. Service is at 9:30, but worship is all the time. Amen? Service is at 9:30, but worship is all the time. Service is at 9:30, but worship is all the time. Amen? 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 I always say, listen, I don't know what you came to do. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to worship. I know that we go through an entire week of computers, of cell phones, of paying bills, of children, of doctor's appointments, of worrying, of crying, of laughter, of loved ones. We go through an entire week. We see each other, we don't see each other, of driving, of lots of different things. And then we get to this point. And so let's spend some time in worship. Let's spend some time in worship. I don't know what you come to do, but let's spend some time in worship. Let's spend some time in worship. This, because this is the reason why we're here. We're here to worship. We're here to worship. That's why we're here. There's no other place like it. There's no other place like it. You leave your home, some of you. You leave your places, your bedrooms to get right here. Thank you, Nicole, for joining us, and Cindy. You leave your bedrooms, you leave your places, and you get right here in front of your screens to worship. To worship. So let's do that thing. Let's worship in spirit and in truth. So let's do that thing that we did last week. Everybody, go ahead and take a breath in. Inhale, and go ahead and exhale. One more time, inhale, and exhale. Because guess what? That's a gift. That right there was a gift that somebody didn't receive last night. And so let's give God thanks and praise. Let's give God thanks and praise for the gift and the gift of life. And we thank you. We thank you as we begin our worship. Thank you, Pastor Ann Therese, for helping lead us in. And thank you, Judy, for helping lead us in.
Thanks, Pastor Kim. And we are grateful to start this morning with our prelude from our music minister, Judy. Glory to God. Thank you.
As the next few slides advance, we want to welcome each and every one of you, and we want to formally say Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all of those that are here with us virtually as well as in person, and to those that celebrate, those that will join us later on through our website, through Facebook, as well as our YouTube station. Happy Father's Day. To those that are here right now, Happy Father's Day to you. I want to make sure I say a special Father's Day to, I know that my father, Harvey Kendrick, that will watch, as well as my brother, Brian Kendrick. Happy Father's Day to all of you that celebrate. Happy Father's Day to you. I want to also make sure that we give a special welcome to those that are with us for the very first time here at Glenside United Church of Christ. My name is Reverend Kim Kendrick. I proudly serve as the interim pastor here at Glenside United Church of Christ, where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at Glenside United Church of Christ. If you're with us virtually and you're on the Zoom, go ahead and type in the chat, welcome. If you're here with us in the sanctuary, go ahead and wave your hands, turn around. There might be someone here for the first time or the second time. Go ahead and wave to each other. Since we don't pass the peace, give somebody a holy high five, a glorious fist bump. Turn around and see to your neighbor. I know we're masked up. Go ahead in the chat and wave to each other. Say hello, welcome. It's good to see each other so that we can go ahead and say welcome, because you are welcome here. We worship during the summertime at 9:30. It's good to see you as we worship in spirit and truth as we continue in our worship experience. Thank you so much to Minister Judy as we continue in our worship experience with our next song. And we will be treated to the worship experience with our sermon for today, poured into the vessel of our guest preacher, the Reverend Kendal Brown. We are so glad and delighted that he will be with us on this Sunday. Won't you come today? And we have our call to worship. Thank you. Our call to worship, after we will have our call to worship, our readings, and then we will have Minister Judy bring us our song. Thank you so much. Thank you for being our worship leader.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's awesome when all the people live together in unity. We hold each other tightly when the sea begins to swallow us. We hold each other tightly when we fall around. But we also need God and each other when there are no As people of paradox, we long to oneness with ourselves and others, with Christ and creation, so that justice and love may flow freely. God's grace washes upon the turbulent shores of our lives, and we are forgiven to begin again, to live at peace with ourselves and others, with Christ and creation, allowing justice and love to flow freely through our lives. Let's offer each other a sign of Christ's peace. Where they get organized to fight the Philistines. The Philistines took position on one hill, while Israel took position on the opposite hill. There was a valley between them. A champion named Goliath in Gath came out from the Philistine camp. He was more than 9 feet tall. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore bronze scale armor weighing 125 pounds. He had bronze plates on his shins and a bronze scimitar armor on his back. His spear shaft was as strong as a bar on a weaver's loom, and his iron head weighed 15 pounds. His shield bearer walked in front of him. He stopped and shouted to the Israelite troops, "Why have you come and taken up battle formation? I am the Philistine champion, and you are Saul's servants. Isn't that right? Select one of your men and let him come down against me. If he is able to fight me, if not, then we will become your slaves. But if I will overcome him and kill him, then you will become our slaves, and you will serve us. I insult Israel's troops today," the Philistine continued. "Give me an opponent and we'll fight." When Saul and all the only Israel heard what the Philistine said, they were distressed and terrified. Now David was Jesse's son, and Ephraim from Bethlehem in Judah, who had 8 sons. By some time, Jesse employed quite a lot and far along in age. Jesse, the eldest son of the long son of the war. Their names are Leah, the oldest, and Abinadab, the second oldest, and Sam, the third oldest. David was the youngest. These three older sons well and saw that David went back and forth from Saul's side to shepherd his father's flock in Bethlehem. For 40 days straight, the first son came out and took a stand both morning and evening. Jesse said to his son David, please take your brothers and Ephah of his spirit of grain and lose 10 loaves of bread. Deliver them quickly to your brothers in the camp. And here, take these 10 wedges of cheese to their unit commander. Find out how your brothers are doing and bring back some sign that they're okay. They all saw and all the Israelite troops fighting in Philistine in the Gila Valley. So David got up early in the morning, let his army charge the flock and loaded up and left, just as his father Jesse had instructed him. He reached the camp right when the army was taken up by battle formation and shouted the war cry. Israel and the Philistines took up a battle formation opposite each other. David left his things with an attendant and ran to the front line. When he arrived, he asked how his brothers were doing. Right when David was speaking with them, Goliath, the Philistine, champion of God, came forward from the Philistine ranks and said the things he had said before. David listened. When the Israelites saw Goliath, every one of them ran away terrified of him. Now the Israelite soldiers had been saying to each other, do you see this man who keeps coming out? Come and come to him, he said, insult Israel. The king will reward him with great riches, whoever killed that man. The king will give him his own daughter to him and make his household exempt from taxes in Israel. David asked his soldiers standing by him, what will be done with the person who killed that Philistine over there and who really took his insult from Israel? Who is that uncircumcised Philistine anyway that he can get away with insulting the army of the living God? Then the troops repeated to him what they had been saying. So that's what will be done for the man who kills him, he said. When David's oldest brother, Eliab, heard him talking to the soldiers, he got very mad at David. Why did you come down here? He said. Who is watching over his sheep for you in the wilderness? I know how arrogant you are and your tedious plan. You came down just to do the battle. What did I do wrong this time? David replied. It was just a question. So David turned to someone else and asked the same thing. And the people said the same thing in reply. The things David had said were overheard and reported to Saul, who sent before him. Don't let anyone lose courage because of this Philistine, David told Saul. I, your servant, will go and fight him. You can't come out and fight this Philistine, Saul answered David. You are still a boy, but he's been a warrior since he was a boy. Your servant can protect his father's sheep, David replied to Saul. And if anyone lying or a bear came and carried off one of the flock, I will go after it, strike it, and rescue the animal from its mouth. If it turns on me, I will grab it in the jaws, strike it, and kill it. Your servant has fought both lions and bears. This uncircumcised Philistine will be just like one of them, because he has insulted the army of the living God. The Lord, David added, who rescued me from the power of both lions and bears, will rescue me from the power of the Philistine. Go, Saul replied to David, and may the Lord be with you. Then Saul dressed David in his own gear, put his coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David stuck his sword on over the armor, but he couldn't walk around well because he'd never tried it on before. I can't walk in this, David told Saul, because I've never tried it before. So he took them off. He then grabbed his staff and chose 5 smooth stones from the slinger. He put them in the pocket of his shepherd bag and with slinging arrows went out to the Philistine. The Philistine got closer and closer to David and his shield bearer was in front of him. When the Philistine looked David over, he sneered at David because he was just a boy, reddish brown and good looking. The Philistine asked David, am I some sort of dog that you come at me with sticks? And he cursed David by his gods. Come here, he said to David, and I'll feed your flesh to the wild birds and the wild animals. But David told the Philistine, you are coming against me with sword, spear, and scimitar, but I come against you in the name of the Lord of heavenly forces, the God of Israel's army, the one living someone. Today, the Lord will hand you over to me. I will strike you down in front of your head. Today, I will feed your dead body and the dead bodies of the entire Hillside camp to the wild birds and the wild animals. Then the whole world will know that there is a God on Israel's side. And all those who gather here will know that the Lord doesn't save us by means of sword and spear. The Lord owns this war, and he will hand all of you over to us. The Philistine got up and moved closer to attack David, and David ran quickly to the front line to face him. David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone. He slung it, and it hit the Philistine on the forehead. The stone penetrated his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Sam. Yes.
That was a long reading.
Thank you for that. Thank you. Once again, I want to say happy Father's Day to everyone that celebrates. Happy Father's Day. This is the time in our worship experience for our children's message. Our children's message.
For those that are with us in the sanctuary and
that are online, I'd like to invite our children to lean in. Again, to our children that are here with us in the sanctuary and our children that are online with us, I'd like to invite you to lean in. Amen. I have in front of me a bag. Guess what I have in my bag? Anybody want to guess what I have in my bag? I have in my bag five stones. So for those of you online, I've got five stones. And I picked out five stones because they remind me of the story that Miss Sam just read for us. The story of David and Goliath. The story of David and Goliath. Now, Goliath was a giant, right? A giant. I don't know if he was a giant as we think of Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum, right? But he was a giant in terms of a really, really tall guy. And he was a warrior, right? A warrior. And he was a warrior in terms of he had this big, big shield, right? And when we say shield, he had this big shield, not like this soft pillow, but this huge shield. And he had a sword, right? And he had all this body armor, all this body armor. And he would go into battle. So think of this real tall guy, right? With this big sword and this huge shield. And he was big and tough and gruff and mean. And he had a huge army that would back him up. And everybody was scared of him. And nobody wanted to fight and defeat him. But David, the guy that we talked about last week that was chosen, he came up and said, you know what? I want to try. I want to give it a try and I want to defeat him. Because I believe I'm brave and I think that I can do it. And so David stepped forward. But David was small and he was young. And David looked around and David said, all I have is five stones. And David took his five stones. And David said, I think I can do it with five stones and a slingshot. Have you ever seen a slingshot? I think I've got Josh and Zoe with me today. Have you ever seen a slingshot? Anybody ever seen a slingshot? Even my folks that are online, if you put in the chat, have you ever seen a slingshot? It's kind of like a mask, right? Where you put your stone inside, you don't drop it like that. Don't drop it like that. Good. You put your stone inside of a slingshot and you kind of do something like that, right? And you, right? Yes, yeah, some of the folks are helping me demonstrate. And the stone would go and it would be shot far off and it would go all the way into the air. Well, David had these five stones. And the five stones remind me of certain things. And David wanted to use the five stones to defeat the giant. And the way that he used the five stones to defeat the giant, this is what it reminds me of. He used the first stone, and the first stone reminded me of the things that David really already had within himself. He used the first stone, and the first stone reminds me of courage. David had a lot of courage to step up in the first place to say, you know what? That giant may be 7 feet, 8 feet, 9 feet tall, but I'm going to step up, and I've got a lot of courage. The second stone that David used was confidence. He had a lot of confidence to even say in the first place, I'm going to go in front of all of the other armies, of all of the other people, and I'm going to use my voice. He had courage and he had confidence. The third stone that David used was preparation. He went ahead, he went down to the stream, and he got five stones. How many of you will go ahead in your life and make sure that you're prepared for whatever giants that come along in your life, to make sure that you're prepared for whatever task that you might have? He went down to the stream and he got the five stones in the first place, and he was prepared. So the courage, the confidence, the preparation, the fourth stone is trust. Ms. Sam read for us that David said that he didn't have trust in his own abilities. David had trust in God first. The giant Goliath, he was cursing at David over and over again. But David said, you know what? I put my trust in God first, not in myself and my own abilities. I put my trust in God to defeat the giant. So courage and confidence, preparation and trust. And the fifth stone is victory. We're all going to have our giants in life. We're all going to have decisions that we make. We're all going to have giants in our life, whether it's making the right decisions, whether it's having difficult conversations, whether it's making new friends, going to new schools, getting good grades. Confidence, courage, preparation, trust, and victory. What are the things in our lives that the five things, these are some of the five things that we can hold and take with us all the time and carry with us. And God helps us each and every day to walk with us, to nurture us, to hold with us. And we thank God for those, to tackle the giants and the giant things that are in our lives. And I pray that each and every one of you will hold them with you and in your hearts each and every day. Won't you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we thank you. We thank you so much for helping us tackle the giants and the giant things in our lives. Help us to have courage. Help us to have confidence. Help us with preparation and trust and victory in you. We thank you, God. We worship you. We praise you always. In Jesus' name, amen.
Troubled clouds and my heart burdened me.
Our second reading this morning is from the Acts of the Apostles. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. All at once, there was such a violent earthquake that it shook the prison's foundations. The doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. When the jailer awoke and saw the open doors of the prison, he thought the prisoners had escaped, so he drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul shouted loudly, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." The jailer called for some lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He led them outside and asked, "Honorable masters, what must I do to be rescued?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your entire household." They spoke the Lord's word to him and everyone else in his house. Right then, in the middle of the night, the jailer welcomed them and washed their wounds. He and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. They brought them into his home and gave them a meal. He was overjoyed because he and everyone in his household had come to believe in God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Glenside, when I invited our guest speaker, I specifically invited the Reverend Kendal Brown because he is a friend. In your bulletin, you can read his bio. When I asked him to send his bio, I read his bio. When I read his bio, I laughed out loud to the core of my belly because he redacted and edited the numerous accolades and titles and positions that this man of God has held. The numerous. When he says minister, when he says entrepreneur, when he says former seminary admissions director and former denominational staff for the UCC, he is completely underselling himself. I met him in 2011 when I said, "The cemetery? I don't have any money to go to the cemetery." He said, "Girl, I'm talking about seminary. You need to go to seminary to get a good quality education so that you can do the right thing when you are standing in front of people to talk about God and to teach people the word of God and to know what you're talking about, to do the right thing." I said, I don't have a dime. I said, I got a family. I have a mortgage. I said, how do you do that thing? I said, I've got a job, a full-time job. What are you talking about? I live over an hour and a half away. And the Reverend Kendal Brown said to me something I will never forget. He said, "Where God leads, God will feed. And where God guides, God will provide." Where God leads, God will feed. And where God guides, God will provide. He said, "The church will hire you. God is your employer." And I have never forgotten that. And in 2014, I graduated from Lancaster Theological Seminary. And this is the picture that I took on that graduation day with the Reverend Kendal Brown, with my daughter, my firstborn, my first heart.
And so the words that you hear right now are from my good friend, my mentor, the Reverend Kendal Brown. Please welcome him as we can with a good hearty welcome from Glenside United Church of Christ, the Reverend Kendal Brown.
Good morning, people of Glenside. My name is Reverend Kendal Brown, and I am excited to be with you this morning. A special word of thanks to my friend and colleague, Reverend Kim Kendrick, for this opportunity to share this morning. And I'd also like to say Happy Father's Day to all of those who are celebrating today and hope that you have a wonderful day. For a few brief moments, I would like to speak from the subject The Church at Midnight, and using as a theme Acts 16th chapter, verses 25 through 34. Would you pray with me? Consecrate us now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let our souls look up with a steadfast hope, and may our wills be lost in thine. Amen. Some of you may or may not know, in a previous role, I worked with the Central Atlantic Conference of the United Church of Christ, supporting churches and clergy who were coming into the UCC. But in addition to that, I also worked with churches around congregational vitality and church growth. And though I'm no longer in that role, I'm still plugged into those conversations. And this past year and a half, I've been thinking a lot about our churches and what church will look like on the other side of this pandemic. I've been thinking about what will happen to faith communities that were already concerned about livelihood, identity, and survival in a rapidly changing world. I've been thinking about how do we live into this current reality? What is our posture? What are the guiding principles? And I hope you take some time to think about these questions we're facing both individually and collectively, because good and thoughtful questions can yield wonderfully rich and life-giving answers. And so it is with these questions as a backdrop that I invite you to reflect on today's passage of scripture from the book of Acts. The text says that at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing praises to God. One of my favorite writers, Reverend Barbara Brown Taylor, writes in her book, Learning to Walk in the Dark, about reframing the night and darkness. Brown Taylor writes, "Through darkness, we find courage. We understand the world in new ways. And we feel God's presence around us, guiding us through things seen and unseen. Often," she writes, "it is while we are in the dark that we grow the most." And I want to invite you, people of Glenside, to reflect upon life at midnight. Not in ways that romanticize the night, not in ways that over-spiritualize the night or dismiss its sometimes harsh realities. But I want you to think about what it means to be the church at midnight. Think about what it means to glean and gather all that the midnight can teach us about ourselves, about one another, about our faith, about our world. I believe that Paul and Silas here in this passage are offering us a roadmap for navigating the night. The text says that at midnight, Paul and Silas found themselves in jail, and they prayed and sang praises to God. There they were, beaten and bound, thrown in jail for living out the gospel. But at midnight, we find them doing something peculiar and counterintuitive, praying and singing praises unto God. And the text tells us that suddenly there was an earthquake so violent that it shook the very foundation of the prison. And not only were Paul and Silas freed, but all the prisoners were freed, the text tells us. I grew up in Black Baptist and Pentecostal circles, and I grew up hearing older folks talk about finding joy in the midst of sorrow and finding hope in difficult places. And I thought that all of those things were trite and merely just cliches. But now that I've lived a few years, I know that they were on to something. If the church has anything to offer to the world, it offers a space for cultivating joy, even in the midst of life's most difficult situations. In a world that wants to drown us in cynicism and the pursuit of more and more and more without any recognition of the abundance that we already have, the world needs a church that embodies gratitude. The world needs a church where people can gather, both virtually and in person, in times of difficulty and chaos. A place that can be strength for and to one another. We do have a purpose, people of God. Our purpose is to fill the corner with song and celebration, especially during times of midnight seasons. I found out, people of God, that it is hard to be overcome with worry when we are expressing gratitude. It may sound trite, but it's hard to worry and worship at the same time. I challenge you, find ways to celebrate, to praise at midnight, and do it often. Yes, work for justice, do it relentlessly. Fight the evils of our present age, but do not forget to sing. Civil rights matriarch Fannie Lou Hamer said that she led people in song because it eased their minds while they were resisting evil. If you want to see the chains fall off, as a community, find reasons to sing praises at midnight. Celebrate small victories. Celebrate big victories. Celebrate the beauty of creation. Celebrate the joy of diversity. Celebrate the fact that we are not alone in this world as long as we stay in community. Celebrate the fact that we have one another in community. Release gratitude into the world and watch how gratitude elevates you and lifts you and in turn lifts us all. For every midnight, find ways to infuse those times with gratitude. Gratitude in word, gratitude in deed, gratitude in song. And that gratitude will not only free us and liberate us, but that gratitude liberates and frees those who are around us and who are in relationship to us. But not only does this text remind us to offer gratitude, the next lesson from our text is found in verse number 26. The text says that suddenly there was an earthquake so violent that it shook the foundations of the prisons, and the prison was shaken, and everyone in the prison was freed. In most cases, an earthquake would be viewed negatively. However, in this situation, there was something of redeeming value in this earthquake. This earthquake did not destroy them, but it freed them. Regardless of what we say, none of us truly know what God was, where God was, where God is in the midst of a global pandemic. that's above my pay grade. I don't even pretend to know where God was in all of this. And while I don't believe in a deity who brought about the pandemic to teach us lessons, as some would say, I do believe, however, that we can use this pandemic to reflect upon what we are doing and how we are doing it. And I do believe that good can come even out of a horrible situation such as a global pandemic. As we cross over into a vaccinated world, churches have the opportunity to think deeply about mission. What is important? What's less important? What is our purpose? We have the opportunity, friends, to think about how we do church. And perhaps, just perhaps, the pandemic can free us from some of the things that have shackled us for decades and for decades. During the pandemic, the church left the building. And guess what? The church survived. And some churches have even thrived in unimagined ways. Guess what? The church found out that every meeting does not have to be in person. Glory be to God. The pandemic taught us that faith and community are about checking in on one another. The pandemic taught us that church is about being there for one another, even if it's virtual. The pandemic taught us that we can do church differently. My mother, in the big city of Danville, Virginia, down in Southern Virginia, she's in her late 70s, and every Sunday she attended not one, but two churches virtually. Every Sunday she attended her church and she attended her brother's church 3 hours away from her. She was active in his Sunday school every Sunday, virtual gatherings every Sunday. The pandemic has shown us that we can do things differently. We can work differently. We can think about more accommodating schedules for caregivers. Allow this pandemic to free you to reimagine church, to reimagine your commitments, to reimagine who can be included with you, Glenside, on this journey. Allow this pandemic to allow you to reimagine the blessings that can only emerge out of the ruins of tragedy. Do not go back to business as usual. Let this earthquake bring about liberation from the things that might be holding you back as a church community. And finally, use your freedom wisely. It amazes me that once Paul and Silas were freed, the text tells us that they remained behind. They remained behind to see to the well-being of others. Instead of seeing their newfound freedom as an opportunity to escape, they instead chose to stay behind to attend to the needs of others, even those who had imprisoned them. I guess I'm not as spiritual as Paul and Silas. You got to keep praying for me. I want to ask you today, where in your life have you experienced freedom? Where have you experienced liberation? Where have you experienced the privilege of an opportunity? And my follow-up question to that is, what are you doing with that freedom? Who is being blessed by your freedom? Perhaps it's the freedom afforded from being born in the right zip code and receiving a good education. Perhaps it's the freedom of relatively good health. Perhaps it's aptitude and the wherewithal just to make life work. Perhaps you've been blessed with a supportive network, access to good therapy, access to good anxiety medication. Perhaps it's knowing what you're good at from an early age. What are we doing with the freedom that we have been given? Because all of us have been given something. My question today is, are we hoarding it? Perhaps squandering it out of fear that it will run out? Or are we remaining behind to share with our siblings in need of access to the resources that we have been blessed to receive? When I was active in fundamentalist circles, we used to talk about leaving this world behind, being raptured away, taken away before the world was destroyed and hellfire's flame consumed all those who had rejected God. But my perspective has shifted. I want to focus in my life on remaining behind for the good of the whole. We have been freed to help, only to help others get free. Fannie Lou Hamer also said that none of us are free until all of us are free. This Pride Month, make it your mission to work for someone else's freedom. During this time when racial injustice seems as alive as it's ever been, make it your mission to stay behind and have the difficult conversations with those who are in your circle. Put some skin in the game. Stay behind and help somebody else get free. Make the commitment to stay behind to make sure that folks are okay. What are you doing with your freedom? You can help somebody else get free, even at midnight. It is my hope that this sermon finds a place in your heart as we endeavor to be the body of Christ in this present world. Blessings to you all. God bless you. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Brown, for those powerful, powerful words and for the invitation truly to consider what we do with our liberation and really the challenge to reimagine the ways that we live our freedom, the ways that we consider our mission, and the ways that we include the world around us in all that we do. We thank you. Thank you so much for that profound invitation. And as we hold these words, as we hold this powerful invitation from Reverend Brown, let's take a moment and consider the places and spaces in our lives where we call out to God, where we seek those ways to live into our mission more deeply. I invite you now, if you are in the sanctuary, if you'd like to move to a microphone to lift out the prayers that you'd like to speak aloud, and if you are on Zoom, if you'd like to use the chat to raise up your prayers, to please do so now. And I'll just begin right now by praying a prayer out of dryness. Part of our country right now is experiencing a serious drought, suffering from fires, suffering from thirst. We pray, oh God, for the wisdom to treat our earth with love and with respect, to care for one another and to share its resources. We pray that we may weather the droughts of the West well, and that we may notice the ways that our planet is trying to teach us the need to care for it more deeply. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up the invitation of Reverend Brown during this Pride Month to think about the ways that we can put skin in the game, to reach out and care for one another in powerful ways. We think about the ways that we can love one another more deeply, more profoundly, more radically. We think about those who are different from us in any way or form or fashion. And we think about the ways that we can stand with them and for them. We ask for the courage to do so with love and kindness and bravery. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For what else, my friends, shall we pray this morning?
In the sanctuary, I want to lift up all of those that are grieving, mourning, and that have lost their fathers, and those that have strained relationships with their fathers. Lord, may your mercy hear our prayer. God, I pray for my friend Elizabeth and Adam, who has not regained consciousness after being brought up on the side of the earth. He would have it in the family, and the figure will be sore out to him. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for Catherine Surfer from this Friday.
Precious God, you hear the prayers of our hearts. You've heard the prayers that we speak aloud. You know the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts. We thank you for hearing us. We thank you for accompanying us in our needs, in our thanks, even in the places where we don't even know how to begin to pray. We lift up our prayers together with our brothers, our sisters, our siblings throughout the world, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Loving God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You know, even as we lift up our prayers, my friends, we also lift up our gifts, and it is our gifts of time and talent and treasure that keep this church running. So we thank you for the ways that you share your generosity with Glenside United Church of Christ. We thank you if you are in the sanctuary and remind you that you can continue to share your gifts with us by giving online at www.glensideucc.org or by mailing a check to Glenside United Church of Christ at 2160 Wharton Road, Glenside, PA 19038. If you are watching this online, of course, those are ways that you can give as well. We're grateful for your generosity. As I said, it's your generosity that helps us to do what we do at this church. So thank you so very much for your giving.
Family, this has been an awesome, awesome worship experience, both online as well as in person. Let's stay connected. Let's continue to stay connected as we always worship in spirit and in truth. Let's stay connected through our website at www.glensideucc.org, through Facebook as well as Instagram. You can always email us at admin@glensideucc.org. We have an email that goes out. We also have a newsletter. You can subscribe to our newsletter if you just go to our website. Again, our website is www.glensideucc.org. That's our website. You can always email us to get onto our our newsletter, and our email address is admin@glensideucc.org. You can always just give us a phone call. The telephone number is 215-887-1819. Let's stay connected. I need glasses. Amen, amen. I want to make sure that I, again, say thank you. Thank you and happy Father's Day to Reverend Kendal Brown. Awesome message. Just give him a thank you. Thank you. Because I'm going to be watching. I know he's watching and he will watch. Again, I want to say thank you and happy Father's Day to Reverend Kendal Brown, and happy Father's Day to his husband, the Reverend Dr. Brian Woodford also. Again, happy Father's Day to both of them. Our sending and our benediction. We are the waters. We are the waters in which God swims. Through the currents, crashing waves, and depths of the unknown, a holy presence remains. May God continue charting new courses and ways of being in the world that unites creation and a collective call of peace. And a collective call of peace be still for each and every one of us. May God be with each and every one of you. May Reverend Kendal's words of each and every one of us challenge us for gratitude, to be free, to go out into the world, to reimagine, to reimagine, to reimagine. May God be with you. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday. Enjoy the rest of your week. Praise God. May God be with you. Amen, 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 and thank you. Once again, thank you so much to Jason for serving as our digital hospitality host, and thank you so much, Jason, and happy Father's Day, Jason. Thank you so much. Happy Father's Day, and happy Father's Day to everyone who celebrates. Thank you so much, Sam, for serving as our worship leader. Thank you so much, Minister Judy. Thank you so much to all of our hospitality team for being in here and ushering us in. Are there any announcements? Any announcements? Announcement?
I would like to tell you all about an unusual opportunity that you have. I know that I'm the church nerd, and I go to all these meetings, and you all wonder why. But General Synod is coming up, and it's virtual. And you have an opportunity to participate virtually, which you never ever could have done before and probably won't be able to do again. Well, maybe we'll take this new way of being church more seriously at the national level too. But July 11th to 18th is a general synod. I would encourage you to check into it and look and see what's there, because they have wonderful speakers. And if nothing else, the worship services are amazing. So check it out. And if you want more information, let me know. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I'm sorry. Along the lines of General City, there is an opportunity to have the fee waived. So take a look at that. If you have information that's on in our newsletter, there is an opportunity to have the fee waived if you contact the Pennsylvania Southeast Conference.
Good morning. I just wanted to let you know that through your generous support, Dave and I bought over $900 worth of food to take up to the food cupboard.
Right.
So again, thank you.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Glenside, for your generosity to the food cupboard. Are there any other announcements?
Good morning. The microphones are... Thank you. Good morning. I just wanted to mention that that last duet was our first duet that we videotaped with two young people that are not family members. So they were very excited about coming in, Cadence and Kyle, and we so appreciate their gifts. We hope you'll join us next Sunday for contemporary praise worship. Very excited to have Andre back there singing at the end of the service with a singer's mask, and we are very excited about what is going on, not only with traditional worship and traditional music, but with our contemporary praise ensemble. So hope you can join us next Sunday for that. Thank you.
Amen, amen. Thank you for your leadership with that, Minister Judy. Are there any other announcements? Any other announcements before we stop or end our recording? Any other announcements from our virtual world? Any other announcements in the sanctuary? I want to again thank you all for being here with us. Thank you so much for all of those that are online. Make sure you come back again next week. We will be here at 9:30. We're, again, as always, with Glenside, we worship in spirit and in truth. Be with us, whether you're online, whether you're live with us. Come back again next week at 9:30. We're going to end our formal recording. Amen and amen. Enjoy the rest of your